And as you can see, there were, as of 2014, there were 387 million people with diabetes altogether, type 1 and type 2 both, worldwide. Out of these, 29 million people were in US, which constitute 9.3% of the US population, and about 13% of all the adult population. Out of these 29 million diabetics, about 2 to 3 million people have type 1 diabetes. And diabetes, as we know, is a leading cause of kidney failure. It constitutes about 44% of all the causes of kidney failure in US. And it's a major burden on our healthcare cost. The indirect and direct cost attributed to diabetes on our healthcare system is about $245 billion. Now, insulin therapy, as we know, is the standard of care for patients with type 1 diabetes, as well as a small proportion of patients with type 2 diabetes, about 20 to 30%. Insulin therapy is life-saving for a lot of these patients, but it is still a treatment. It's not a cure. It does affect quality of life because patients are required to frequently monitor their blood glucose, and they have to adjust their insulin. There is always this fear of hyperglycemia, so that affects their quality of life. And eventually, when patients are on insulin, despite intensive glucose control and despite all the efforts of trying to keep hemoglobin A1C less than 6.5 or less than 7, patients still go on developing secondary complications like retinopathy, neuropathy, gastroparesis, and so forth.
Okay, we got it. All right, thanks.
Sorry. Okay, so there are different ways of insulin therapy. And these are, you can use syringes and needles, you can use insulin pen, or you can use insulin pump. The goal of insulin therapy is to lower down the hemoglobin A1C to a goal of less than 7. Or the goal could be higher or lower, depending on how much risk of hypoglycemia we want to take. In patients who can tolerate hemoglobin A1C of 6.5, and these are the patients who are type 2 diabetic, on oral hypoglycemics, or patients who are young, who can control, the patients in which we can target A1C less than 6.5, so that target can be achieved. But as you can see in this figure, the lower is the hemoglobin A1C, the lower is the risk of microvascular complications like retinopathy, nephropathy, neuropathy, and microalbuminuria. But despite these goals of hemoglobin A1C less than 6.5 or less than 7, worldwide, only less than 50% patients with type 2 diabetes achieve this goal. So you can see that in US, only 42% patients with type 2 diabetes are achieving A1C goal of less than 7. So what about patients with type 1 diabetes? So I'm sure this crowd is aware of the original DCCT trial, which was published in NEJM in 2003. And in that trial, it was shown that intensive insulin therapy was better than conventional insulin therapy in lowering down the risk of microvascular complications. So this study here, which was published in Archives of Internal Medicine in 2009, followed the same DCCT cohort of type 1 diabetic patients, about 1,400 patients. 1,400 patients of DCCT cohort and about 160 patients of ADIC cohort for a total of 30 years of their diabetes duration. And what this study found was that the type 1 diabetic patients during this study follow-up of 30 years who maintained their hemoglobin A1C less than 7 was less than 20%, only 13 to 19%. And although the incidence of retinopathy, nephropathy, and cardiovascular disease was lower compared to conventional insulin therapy, the incidence was still pretty high, 21% for retinopathy, 9% for nephropathy, and for cardiovascular disease. So why is that? I mean, even though you're trying to achieve this intensive insulin therapy, patients are still not achieving it because, number one, they fear about hypoglycemia. Number two, even if the patients are able to achieve A1C less than 7, there is significant variation of the blood glucose outside the normal range. So you're achieving hemoglobin A1C less than 7, but despite that, glucose may vary greatly outside the normal range. And that's why there is risk of complications in the long term. So now coming to the pancreas transplant and its rationale. So pancreas transplant compared to patients with type 1 diabetes provide complete insulin independence. There is complete glycemic control and durable normalization of A1C. Improvement in secondary complications, improvement in hypoglycemic unawareness, which is not seen despite intensive insulin therapy in patients with type 1 diabetes. Quality of life is improved, and patient survival is improved. So I will go over each one of these briefly in my next few slides. So this is one of the early studies which showed that hemoglobin A1C normalized after pancreas transplant, and that the normal hemoglobin A1C was maintained up to 5 years post-transplant, and the A1C was around 6.5 range. This is another study which was published in more recently, and this study had follow-up of up to 10 years, and the study showed that fasting blood glucose as well as hemoglobin A1C were maintained within the normal range in that 10-year of follow-up period. And as you can see, that the fasting glucose did go up from 78 to 91 mean, and A1C went up from 4.6 to 5.3 mean, but these are still well within the normal range. So what is the effect of pancreas transplant on diabetic retinopathy? So as you can see in this slide, patients who received pancreas transplant compared to patients who did not get transplant, and those were the patients who were type 1 diabetic receiving insulin therapy, compared to those patients, majority of patients, about 91% patients, either had improvement or stabilization of their retinopathy, compared to only 43% patients receiving insulin therapy. And you also, and what you see is there was worsening of retinopathy in about 20 to 30% patients, but this number was significantly less compared to patients who were type 1 diabetic. And this can happen in patients who have unstable eye disease. They get pancreas transplant, so it can happen because they already had underlying unstable disease of retina. But this number is lower than the patients who did not get a transplant. Pancreas transplant also improves the nerve conduction velocities. So in patients with established diabetic neuropathy, you can see that the motor, sensory, and autonomic indices in patients with pancreas transplant shown in the open circle here, compared to patients with type 1 diabetes shown in the closed circles, there is improvement in all these indices over time when patients were followed for up to 42 months post-transplant. So what is the effect of pancreas transplant on diabetic nephropathy? As you can see in this data, the patients who received pancreas transplant, they had early diabetic nephropathy, they had normal creatinine clearance, but they all had microalbuminuria of 103 milligram in 24 hours. So post pancreas transplant at 5 years, the albuminuria completely resolved, and it stayed like this at 10 years follow up. Creatinine clearance actually did go down post pancreas transplant, but afterwards it stayed stable. So this is what we actually see in our clinical practice as well, that the kidney function does go down after a pancreas transplant, but eventually it stabilizes. It stays stable over time. These are the images of a kidney biopsy from patient from the same study. The patient had type 1 diabetes for 17 years. The kidney biopsy was taken at baseline at the time of pancreas transplant in panel A. Panel B is at 5 years post-pancreas transplant, and panel C is at 10 years post-transplant. So what you see in this panel A is you see those typical nodular lesions of diabetic nephropathy, and these are called Kimmel-Steele-Wilson's lesions. So you see the patient has established diabetic nephropathy. At 5 years, you might see some improvement, but not much. But at 10 years, you see marked resolution of those nodules. So those nodules are completely gone by 10 years. Now, one of the major problems of patients with type 1 diabetes is hypoglycemic unawareness. And these patients with hypoglycemic unawareness, they have a decreased response to hypoglycemia in terms of epinephrine and glucagon response. Now, patients who receive pancreas transplant compared to type 1 diabetes, you see the epinephrine as well as glucagon response to step hyperglycemia. And these figures are showing you that the hyperglycemia was induced. It was stepped hyperglycemia over time. And you see there is an increase in epinephrine response as well as glucagon response. But that does not happen in patients with diabetes. Okay. So patients have improved epinephrine and glucagon response as well as symptoms of hypoglycemic unawareness. So patients become better aware of hypoglycemic symptoms after they get a pancreas transplant. So again, you see that after pancreas transplant, they have better symptom score compared to patients with type 1 diabetes. Now, majority of studies have shown that quality of life is improved post pancreas transplant. And why is that so? Because studies again have found that patients find it easier to take immunosuppression medications compared to taking insulin 4 or 5 times a day and checking their glucose. So quality of life does improve as shown in majority of these studies. Now let's switch gears and I'm going to talk a little bit about history. The first successful pancreas transplant was performed in 1966 by Dr. Kelly and Lalai. This is the image from that transplant. And what we do currently is not much different than what was done at that time. So basically, the pancreas, which is attached to the duodenum, was taken in block and was transplanted into the recipient. The recipient was a 28-year-old woman who received pancreas along with the kidney. So this was a case of a simultaneous pancreas kidney transplant. And what they found was blood sugar decreased immediately after transplant. So this case provided first proof of concept that pancreas transplant can work in humans. And since then, thousands of pancreas transplants have been performed in US and worldwide. And as of December 2011, about 26,000 pancreas transplants had been performed in US versus about 15,000 in rest of the world. So the types of pancreas transplants which are performed comes under 3 categories. The first one, simultaneous pancreas kidney transplant, which is performed in about 75% cases. The criteria for that is patients with kidney failure and type 1 diabetes. The second category is pancreas after kidney transplant, and these are the patients who have type 1 diabetes with kidney disease. They have received kidney transplant and now they are getting a pancreas after kidney. And this constitute about 15% cases. Pancreas transplant alone is performed only in 10% patients. And these are the patients who have normal kidney function, but they just have type 1 diabetes and there are certain indications for transplant, which I will go over. So now we have learned that pancreas transplant improves quality of life, complications either stabilize or get better over time, and overall it's helpful for the patients. So, but is pancreas transplant an option for all the patients with type 1 diabetes mellitus? So that's the question we are asking. Well, not, it's not, because there are 2 million people with type 1 diabetes. There are 35,000 new cases of type 1 diabetes diagnosed every year. Now, we cannot meet this demand with just supply of 1,000 to 1,200 pancreas transplants which are done every year. We have the potential to do more pancreas transplants, and I will go over this later, but that number is going to be within 1,500 to 2,000 pancreas transplants per year, even if we have to perform more transplants. So then, whom out of these 2 million people with type 1 diabetes we should select for pancreas transplant? So what is the criteria? So the criteria is given by ADA, American Diabetes Association, and these criteria are patients have type 1 diabetes, they have normal kidney function, and they have either history of frequent acute severe metabolic complications like hypoglycemic unawareness or diabetic ketoacidosis. So this is the subset of patients with type 1 diabetes who will derive the most mortality or survival benefit, because these patients are facing a life-threatening situation or life-threatening complication. So if you transplant them, there might be some survival benefit. The second indication could be the patients who have incapacitating clinical and emotional problems, which is affecting their quality of life with exogenous insulin therapy. So this is a soft indication, but most of the patients we transplant are the ones who have PKA or who have hypoglycemic unawareness, because those are the patients who are likely to benefit the most with the pancreas transplant. But the question now is, does pancreas transplant improve mortality? Does it improve survival? So this question was looked at in a study which was published in JAMA in 2003. And in this study, they compared the mortality of patients who were on the wait list for pancreas transplant, and they were still receiving insulin, and they compared the mortality with the patients who had received pancreas transplant. The patients who had received pancreas transplants were about 672. And what they found was there was an overall increase in the relative risk of death with pancreas transplant. So the relative risk was 1.6 or higher. So why is that so? Why is the risk of death is higher in patients who are receiving pancreas transplant? Because I just said patients, there should be a mortality benefit. Well, we know that the risk of mortality is high in first 90 days because you're doing a surgical procedure and you're adding a surgical risk. So that is there with any surgery. You're adding a surgical risk. Plus, patients after pancreas transplant, they are on immunosuppression. They are prone to more infections, cancers, cardiovascular disease because of immunosuppression. So that could increase the risk of death. But there were serious methodological flaws in this study. When another set of authors went back and they looked at this data, and they found that there were a lot of errors which had been done while this data was analyzed. One of them was inclusion of patients with kidney function, with abnormal kidney function. So patients whose creatinine was more than 2 were included in this data, which actually artificially increased their mortality. So another set of authors, they went back, they looked at this data, the same data of UNOS from 1995 to 2000. And what they found was there was no increase in mortality overall. So overall mortality or hazard ratio was 1.45, but it was not significant. Okay, within first 90 days or within first year, the hazard ratio of death after pancreas transplant was still high. The p values were significant, but after first year, you see that the hazard ratio is much lower. Okay, so if patients survive pancreas transplant after first year, they have survival benefit, but maybe not within first year. This is what the study showed. But overall, even though there is no survival benefit, even though there is no mortality increase in mortality, there is no survival benefit either. So these two papers came out. Actually, the first paper came out, and after that, we saw a decline in the number of pancreas transplants performed in US. This is the most recent data. The study was published in JAMA in last year, and what that study did was it actually looked at the UNOS database for over a longer period of time, over 25 years, from 1987 to 2012. And again, they compared the mortality between patients who got transplant versus those who were on the wait list. And again, what they found was, in both these categories, pancreas transplant alone, as well as simultaneous pancreas kidney transplant, pancreas transplant actually saved almost 80,000 life years since 1987. And pancreas transplant alone saved almost 15,000 life years since 1987. And patients who received pancreas transplant, whether in the SPK category or pancreas transplant alone, they actually lived longer compared to patients on the wait list. Okay, so this data actually puts everything, all the doubts at rest that there is definitely a survival benefit with pancreas transplant in the long term. In the short term, there might be a mortality, there might be a higher mortality, but in the long term, there is a survival benefit with pancreas transplant alone. Now, coming to the indications for simultaneous pancreas kidney transplant. So who are the candidates? These are the patients who are type 1 diabetic, and how do we identify them? These are the patients on insulin, and their C-peptide is less than or equal to 2 nanogram per ml. So that's the criteria which is used by the UNOS. Plus, these patients are either on dialysis or their GFR or creatinine clearance is less than 20. So that criteria less than 20 is required to be list them for pancreas kidney transplant. Now, patients with type 1 diabetes on dialysis, what are their options? Their options are they can stay on dialysis, they can get a kidney, from a living donor or from a deceased donor, or they can get a simultaneous pancreas kidney transplant. So these are the options. Now, what you see is the survival is the best with simultaneous pancreas kidney transplant in the long term, followed by a living donor kidney transplant, followed by a deceased donor, and the worst survival you see is in patients on dialysis with type 1 diabetes. So survival is only about 20-25% at 5 years. Okay. So if you have a type 1 diabetic patients on dialysis, survival is only 20-25%. The next question which is frequently asked is there a role for pancreas transplant in type 2 diabetes mellitus? Well, answer is yes and no. This slide shows you the characteristics of patients with type 1 and type 2 diabetes. And as we know, the type 1 diabetic patients are, they are younger, they are lean, they have evidence of autoimmune disease. These patients have usually very low or undetectable C-peptide. In contrast, type 2 diabetic patients are usually older, they are obese, they have insulin resistance, and they have detectable, normal or elevated C-peptide. But we also know that in patients with renal failure, for example, C-peptide is not reliable because C-peptide is a peptide, it's a protein, it's excreted by the kidneys. So if you have a type 1 diabetic patient on dialysis, that C-peptide, whatever C-peptide that pancreas is producing is going to hang around, okay? And you will have a detectable C-peptide even though patient is type 1. So that distinction becomes very blurred. Again, there are patients who are type 2, but they are young, they are lean, and they were started on insulin right away. So again, there is a lot of overlap. In fact, if you give patients eligible patients who are lean, thin, requiring insulin, if you give them a pancreas transplant, they will have the same benefit as any patient with type 1 diabetes. And that has been shown in multiple studies. So coming to the simultaneous pancreas kidney transplant for type 2 diabetes, and as you can see in this slide, patients who were type 2 diabetics who received simultaneous pancreas kidney transplant here had the same patient survival compared to patients who were type 1 diabetics receiving simultaneous pancreas kidney transplant. And same thing here, patients also had the similar graft survival. So type 2 diabetic patients receiving SPK had the same graft survival as type 1 receiving SPK. Also, what we have found is that C-peptide level does not impact either patient or graft survival. So irrespective of the C-peptide level, whether the C-peptide is undetectable or if it is 10, it does not matter in terms of the survival of patients or the graft survival. So, but the one thing is the patients who were selected for SPK in these studies, and I have mentioned some more studies here, In these studies, they were not obese. They were all insulin dependent. So they were acting like type 1. So who were these patients? These are the patients who were actually usually younger. Their BMI was less than 30. They were insulin dependent. And they were requiring insulin for at least minimum of 5 years pre-transplant. And their total insulin requirement was less than 1 unit per kilogram per day. So what does that mean? So they were not insulin, they were not overtly insulin resistant. Because if your insulin requirement is like 100 units of insulin per day, probably the pancreas is not going to make that much insulin. So insulin requirement was reasonable, was less than 1 unit per kilogram per day. And these patients were considered low cardiac and vascular disease risk. So they were otherwise healthy to undergo a pancreas transplant along with a kidney. So this data has built up over the last decade or so. And based on this new information, the new UNOS pancreas allocation scheme, which came out in October 2014, actually has expanded the allocation of simultaneous pancreas kidney transplant for patients with type 2 diabetes who meets these following criteria. And these criteria are patients are on insulin and their C-peptide is more than 2, which defines that these patients are type 2 diabetic. their BMI is less than or equal to maximum allowable BMI, which is currently less than or equal to 30. And these patients are on dialysis, or their GFR or creatinine clearance is less than or equal to 20. So what is maximum allowable BMI? So now we know that type 2 diabetic patients, they constitute 90 to 95% of all the diabetic population, right? So if I'm giving kidney pancreas to all the diabetic patients, they will exhaust the whole list and they will deprive the type 1 diabetics from getting SPK, right? So the idea is that we do not want type 2 diabetic patients who receive SPK to be more than 15% of the wait list, but also not less than 10% of the wait list. So we want to keep this number between 10 to 15%. And if type 2 diabetic patients are more than 15% of the wait list for SPK, there is a provision to reduce the maximum allowable BMI, which I talked earlier, by 2. So currently it's 30. Now let's say in the future we find that 20% patients with type 2 diabetics are receiving SPK, then we can actually go down by 2 kilograms per meter square in BMI. So from 30 to 28, we can go down. And if they constitute less than 10% of the wait list, then there is a provision to increase the BMI by 2. Okay, but this number cannot go above 30. It can go below 30, but it cannot go above 30. So currently it's less than or equal to 30. Now, if you look at this OPTN data as of 2012, only 10.3% patients with type 2 diabetes were listed for SPK, or simultaneous pancreas kidney. So this number is actually is where we want it. Some of the contraindications for pancreas transplant: patients have to be in good health. So we do thorough screening of their cardiac status, stress test, echo, make sure they don't have any significant lung disease, doing the routine cancer screening, ruling out any cancer. Patients should not have any chronic infection like osteomyelitis, HIV infection. Patients should show medical compliance. If they have history of non-compliance, probably they're not a good candidate, because they have to be on immunosuppression, which they have to take religiously after transplant. If there are signs that there might be medical non-compliance, and if there are risk factors like substance abuse, or the patient do not show understanding about the process of transplant, or we have doubt about their ability to take the immunosuppression medications post-transplant because of either psychiatric disease or lack of social support, then they are not candidate for transplant either. Now, coming to the methodology of pancreas transplant. So technically, it's not pancreas transplant. It's pancreatico-duodenal transplant. So the pancreas, which is attached to the second part of duodenum, is procured in block from the deceased donor. Okay. So you see that the pancreas is attached to the second part of duodenum. So you do the excision at the upper and the lower portion of the duodenum, take all your vessels out, and then you prepare this pancreatico-duodenal transplant for transplanting it in a recipient. So this is called back table preparation. In this, what people do is you oversaw the donor duodenum edges. So you oversaw it here. You connect an iliac artery graft, which is shown in the red here, in the dark red, to the donor superior mesenteric artery as well as splenic artery. And if necessary, the donor portal vein. So remember, the donor portal vein is where your insulin is coming from. So donor portal vein can be extended further by using an iliac vein graft. So this back table preparation may take about a couple of hours. And when this is ready, then you transplant it in the recipient. So the donor duodenum, the Y graft is connected to the recipient iliac artery. Okay, so that will provide the arterial circulation. The portal vein is connected either to the recipient's common iliac or external iliac vein, which is called systemic venous drainage, because now you're putting the insulin, which is coming from the donor portal vein, into the systemic circulation. Okay, and this does cause hyperinsulinemia. Whereas in portal venous drainage, you can connect the donor portal vein to the recipient superior mesenteric vein, which drains into the to the recipient's hepatic artery, which will go into the liver. So this is more physiological, but it does cause hyperglycemia, more hyperglycemia, systemic hyperglycemia compared to the systemic venous drainage. But in terms of outcomes, there is no major difference in metabolic parameters and outcomes between these two drainage techniques. So you can perform any one you want. Remember one thing, when we transplant pancreas, it also produces almost a liter of the pancreatic juices, amylase, lipase, bicarb-rich fluid. So this drainage has to be diverted somewhere because we are not interested in the exocrine drainage of pancreas. We are interested in the endocrine portion of the pancreas transplant. So this exocrine drainage is either diverted to bladder, okay? So in which case, you see that the pancreas, which is attached to the donor duodenum, is connected to the recipient bladder, or the donor duodenum is connected to the recipient's jejunum, which is called enteric drainage. So this provides a route to the exocrine secretions to be diverted either into the bladder or to the gut, and then basically it gets either reabsorbed in the body, so that you don't lose all those bicarb-rich juices. Otherwise, patients become acidotic. The disadvantage of bladder drainage is, well, let me first talk about advantages. So it's an easier procedure, which Dr. Amiri will not agree with me because he has expertise in the enteric drainage as well as gastric drainage. But it's considered an easier procedure compared to the enteric drainage. It allows measurement of urinary amylase for monitoring rejection. So all the amylase, lipase, they come into the urine. You can measure the urinary amylase. And if the urinary amylase is going down, that tells us that patient is developing exocrine insufficiency. So as pancreas is losing its function, the urinary amylase, which runs in millions titer, will start going down. And as it is going down, you know that the pancreas is developing some insufficiency. So this provides us an easy way to monitor for rejection of the pancreas transplant. There are disadvantages with this procedure, which is loss of bicarb, which can cause severe metabolic acidosis because you're losing all the bicarb in the urine. So usually these patients are on multiple doses of bicarb. They're taking 20 to 30 pills of sodium bicarbonate per day. Urine can reflux back in the pancreas, which can cause reflux pancreatitis, which happens more commonly in the patients with neurogenic bladder. Because pancreatic juices, amylase, lipase, they irritate the bladder wall. That can cause persistent bladder inflammation and hematuria and cystitis as well. In terms of how commonly these techniques are performed, so you see that systemic endocrine drainage is performed more commonly than portal endocrine drainage. Although portal drainage is more physiological, and portal drainage is what we perform at our center as well. Enteric drainage is performed more commonly than the bladder drainage. We do not perform either one of these at our center. What we do is we actually connect the donor duodenum to the recipient's stomach. So that allows an easy way to monitor the pancreas, because you can do the upper GI scope, and you can look at the pancreas, you can look at the donor duodenum, because there is an ostomy in the gastrium. So that provides an easy route to surveillance, for long-term surveillance of these patients. Some of the complications which may develop after pancreas transplants are bleeding, infection, duodenal segment leak, and these complications may develop early on. Venous thrombosis is a major complication which can happen immediate after transplant, and that happens because when patients are, let's say if patients are hypertensive, and pancreas transplant is a low blood flow organ, the blood flows in the pancreas very slowly compared to kidney. So in the setting of hypertension, there is a predisposition for venous thrombosis. And when that happens, basically the pancreas is all dead, and you see a surge of hyperglycemia. You don't see rise in amylase or lipase. You just see that the glucose has gone up. Patient who was well controlled, patient was taken off insulin after transplant, and now patient has just immediate hyperglycemia. Transplant pancreatitis can happen because of infection. Different viral infections can do it, CMV, EBV, or it can happen because of rejection. In the long term, there is risk of malignancy. Type 1 diabetes recurrence due to islet autoimmunity may happen, but is rare. Why? Because patients are on immunosuppression. So that immunosuppression prevents any autoimmune attack on the new pancreas transplant which has been given to the recipient. But that still happens, and the incidence is about 5% in the long term. And if that happens, patients again will develop hyperglycemia. You do not see rejection on the biopsy. What you see is autoimmune antibodies coming back in the patient. Post-transplant diabetes type 2 may develop because, so if you imagine, there are patients who are type 1 diabetic, they are young, they get pancreas transplant, now they are cured of diabetes, but over decades, over time, these patients will gain weight. They are on steroids, they are on cyclosporin or tacrolimus, and all these drugs are diabetogenic. So now these patients have developed diabetes type 2 because they have gained weight and so forth. They will go back on insulin, or they will restart oral hypoglycemics, but their insulin requirement may not be the same as what it was when they first got the pancreas transplant. Now, coming to the outcomes after pancreas transplant, as you can see in this figure, the 1 year and 5 years patient survival outcome has actually improved since 1982. Similarly, graft survival has improved for both 1 and 5 years in all the three categories: pancreas after kidney, pancreas transplant alone, and simultaneous pancreas and kidney transplant. The reason for these improved outcomes is because we have less technical failure now these days compared to back in 60s when the pancreas transplant was first performed. And the risk of graft loss from rejection, or from either from acute rejection or from chronic rejection, has also gone down over years. So in 1966, almost 80% patients, more than 80% patients used to lose their graft because of rejection, because we did not have good immunosuppression. The immunosuppression we were using at that time were azathioprine and prednisone back in 1960s. So in 1980, cyclosporin was invented, and after that, rejection rate went down further. In 1990s, we had introduction of mycophenolate or Cellcept or Myofortic and tacrolimus, and with the advent of these immunosuppression medications, risk of rejection has gone down even further. So now these days, at 1 year, we see the risk of rejection is less than 10%, and this is what we are achieving even for the kidney transplant. So the risk of rejection is less, graft loss is less, outcomes have improved, and what you can expect. The estimated half-life of pancreas transplant after SPK is about 14 years, 7 years for pancreas after kidney and pancreas transplant alone as well. The longest pancreas graft survival time, which has been reported to UNOS, is 26 years for SPK, 24 years for pancreas after kidney, and 23 years for pancreas transplant alone. So currently in the transplant center at Willis-Knighton, we are following some patients who received pancreas transplant about 20 years ago. And they still have a working pancreas. This is the most latest data on outcomes, which was reported by International Pancreas Transplant Registry. And this registry is based at University of Minnesota. So from this registry, the one-year outcome of patient survival is more than 98%, 98 to 99%. And graft survival is more than 85%. And rest of these outcomes are also kind of comparable to the kidney transplant, which is more accepted modality of transplant, I guess more than pancreas transplant. So, but one thing we have seen is that despite these improved outcomes which I just talked about, the number of pancreas transplants which are performed in US has gone down over last decade or so. So in 2003, we performed almost 1,500 pancreas transplants, but since then that number has gone to almost 1,000 pancreas transplants as of 2013. And this number has gone down for all these three categories, PTA, SPK, and PAK. And in 2013, we only did about 150 pancreas transplant alone. So that's not a big number. So 150 pancreas transplant alone in whole US. So what is the reason why there is a decreasing trend in all these types of pancreas transplants? Well, the number one reason is there is a decreased referral for pancreas transplant from our primary care physicians as well as endocrinologists. American Diabetes Association does not consider pancreas transplant as standard of care. Insulin is still considered standard of care, but pancreas transplant is not. And the reason for that is, I think primary care physicians and endocrinologists, they're not aware of the new developments which have taken place in this field. When that paper came out in 2003 in JAMA, which showed higher mortality with pancreas transplant, I think since then the message went out that pancreas transplant is actually increasing mortality over the long term. So since then, the referrals, as you saw, had gone down, and endocrinologists are not aware of the new data about better outcomes with pancreas transplant. So the decreased referrals is one of the major reasons why we are seeing a decreasing trend in all types of pancreas transplant. The second reason is the offers are not as good. As our population is aging, and so is the donor population. In fact, of all the donors who can donate any organ, whether it is a kidney, liver, heart, any organ, only 7% of those donors are considered good donors to be eligible for pancreas donation. So usually pancreases are taken from young, healthy donors. So most of the pancreas donors are young, less than 50. They are not obese. So if they're obese, they're old, then they're not good. They're not good candidates for pancreas donors. So these days, offers are not as good. Because we are only performing 1,000 pancreas transplants in US, there's lack of trained surgeons. So the new surgeons are not trained in pancreas transplants. Dr. Miri, I think, has trained several people in pancreas transplants, and there are only 14 transplant centers in US which are actually training surgeons in pancreas transplant. So lack of training is also another obstacle. And the last reason is low priority. So compared to kidney transplant, where the kidney transplant has received a lot of attention from nephrologists, from transplant society, but in contrast, pancreas transplant has not received that much attention from endocrinologists, primary care physicians, and transplant people. So I think that is another reason why pancreas transplant has not shown an increasing trend over time, which it should. So. But I think if we have more referrals, if we take even not so good offers for pancreas transplant, and if we have more centers performing pancreas transplant, we have the potential to perform almost 1,500 to 2,000 pancreas transplants. So double of what we are performing right now, as per one estimate. But coming to the problem of type 1 diabetes, there are 2 million people with diabetes, and pancreas transplant cannot provide cure to all of them. So we have to look at alternate experimental or new approaches to cure diabetes mellitus. One of them is islet transplant. One of the advantages of islet transplant is that you can use pancreases from the deceased donors, which are coming from old, obese donors, which are not good enough for whole organ pancreas transplant. So you can use these not so good pancreas organs, and then you can use those for isolating the islets. Islet transplant is less invasive, has less morbidity, so it can be performed in patients who are considered surgically high risk. But the islet transplant is still considered experimental. It's not FDA approved in US, and it's not paid by the insurance companies. So that's a limitation. But the outcomes have improved in islet transplant, and eventually in the future it may become a transplant of choice for some patients. What is artificial or bionic pancreas? So it's not actually a pancreas, it's actually a modality of insulin delivery, just like insulin pump. It's a closed loop insulin delivery system, which is fully automatic. It's fully automated, and it is guided by the continuous glucose monitoring. So you have continuous glucose monitoring, that data is fed back into the insulin delivery system, and then patient is given either insulin as well as glucagon to reduce the risk of hypoglycemia. But this device is not available clinically. It's still being perfected, the technology is still being perfected, but maybe in the future it will become a reality and will provide cure to type 1 diabetic patients. Bioartificial pancreas is where you take a bunch of islet cells and then you put them in a pouch, and then you transplant that pouch within the subcutaneous tissue, let it vascularize. That pouch will allow the insulin to be excreted from the islet cells, but will prevent those islets to be attacked by the immune system. Again, bioartificial pancreas is being experimented, but too far from application at this time. Use of stem cells or progenitor cells to create beta cells is also being experimented currently. Xenotransplant. Xenotransplant is a transplant where the transplant is performed between from one species to another. So in that case, typically what happens is you will have hyperacute rejection. If you transplant an organ or cells from one species to another, you will have hyperacute rejection. But the pig islets are more close to the human islets, and the pig insulin is actually closer to human insulin. So there have been attempts made to actually transplant pig islets with immunosuppression on board, or embryonic pancreas, because this embryonic pancreas will then actually grow in that another animal species. It will grow, it will differentiate, and the host will actually adapt to this pancreas. Insulin gene therapy is still in the research area and has not been applied at least in the humans yet. But these are some of the new approaches which are in pipeline and which may provide cure for type 1 diabetes in the future. So in summary, I want to say that pancreas transplant is the best and most reliable way to reduce hemoglobin A1C to a normal level and provides the best treatment option to a selected group of type 1 as well as type 2 diabetic patients, but remains underutilized. Non-obese type 2 diabetic patients requiring insulin and with renal failure should be considered for combined kidney and pancreas transplant. And lastly, new therapies are in pipeline, which will hopefully provide solution to the problem of diabetes in the future. So that's all I have. Thank you for your attention. I will be happy to answer any questions.
Specifically in regards to the pancreas lung transplant, you mentioned quality of life improvement by showing improvement in diabetic complications, but you did not show the complications and quality of life deficits occur because of the immunosuppression. Has anybody looked at just global quality of life indicators in these patients? Because being immunosuppressed chronically, especially if they have their chronic cystitis and they have bladder, that can't be good.
So, actually, I did not go into too much detail because of time constraint, but but all the studies I showed about the quality of life here, they actually looked at patients' quality of life when they were taking insulin versus when they were taking immunosuppression post-transplant. And despite, at least these days, I mean, these are some of the old studies, even these studies showed improvement in quality of life. But even these days, patients are on, in the past, we used to keep patients on a higher immunosuppression dose. They used to have more complications, more side effects. Cyclosporine, for example, had more complications, more side effects than tacrolimus, which we are using currently. These days, we do not use very high doses, number one, because we have more potent immunosuppression. Side effects profile is better in the newer immunosuppression compared to the older immunosuppression. So I believe that quality of life actually is better.
But what indicators do they use for
quality? Okay, that's what you're asking.
Because if you look specifically at, they don't have to use insulin and they neuropathy gets better, retinopathy gets better, then you say they're better.
Mm-hmm.
But if you now add in second malignancies and all these other things, so when I look at quality of life studies, I look at what indicators are they looking at.
Sure.
I don't
exactly know what scale they used. Do you know, Darmiri, what scale they used? I know there are some certain scales available, but I'm not sure what scales they used.
Actually, your question is very important question in dealing with the diabetic patient. The thing which has improved, immediately the insulin requirement disappears. But the gastroparesis, up to 6 months, improves. Retinopathy, the improvement continues up to 5 years. Peripheral neuropathy and cardiac problem, all we have shown that in the literature that they are improving. And especially when you are talking about the hypoglycemic unawareness, is a death sentence for people who have hypoglycemic unawareness. So that is a huge difference. Of course, the issue of immunosuppression and the complication is there lifelong. As Dr. Singh said, it's getting less and less, but it's always there. It's not that much. That problem. We try to also magnify the little bit when we tell to the patient. But in my life, I have seen maybe 10, 15 PTLD, which is post-transplant lymphoproliferative disease, in around 500 transplants that I have done. So it's not that huge of an issue. On and off we see, but we tell them that this problem does exist. So it's not that much, but the quality of life definitely improves in all kind of the pancreas transplant recipient. If I may add one or two comments, one was about the decline of the pancreas transplant, the factor that we're seeing that is correct, but the most important factor which caused the decrease of the pancreas transplant was the premature popularization of the islet transplant. When they talk to the patients and the physicians that the pancreas islet transplant is successful, which is the reality in the future, and we only need islet transplant, we do not need the whole organ. But at this time, we do not have that success. A patient was coming to me that, doctor, when I'm going to come and get my islet infused in your clinic? I said, this is not the reality now. It will be in the future. At this time, the best result that we have with the islet transplant is 10 to 15% 1 year insulin independence. With the whole organ, you saw the result. It's excellent. But when the patient is hearing that you can go and get an injection and the physician do not refer, they are waiting for the islet transplant, so the number comes down. So that is the main reason. And as we are showing that it is not a reality now, and those people who have been trying to popularize, they are backing off from their initial claim, so the number goes up. Is one comment. The other comment was that when you were talking about, I know that it was just a mistake, that when we connect the vein, we do not connect it to the artery. We connect the portal vein to the superior mesenteric vein, which is part of the spinal circulation, which is the portal drainage. So it becomes like an agent. Portal drainage will be exactly the most physiologic type of pancreas transplantation compared to the systemic, which create hyperinsulinemia.
Please go ahead.
We have a lot of patients in clinic, especially like general medicine clinic, that probably qualify for quite a referrals at least for these. What's the most effective way to go about this? Should we refer them to LSU nephrology? I mean, since we don't have it here, it's hard for us to kind of make, where do we send these people for their evaluations? Because most of them, as we know, if they walk to Willis Knighton, they're going to look at them and turn them around and say, you should go back to LSU.
Call me.
Okay.
Call me. You have my phone number. Just call me. Or you can call Dr. Miri.
Okay.
So send the patient back. We love to see the patients.
Yeah.
We have a very busy clinic every Wednesday, and we see everybody. We appreciate that we send the patients, that we never send it back.
Yeah. So last year we did 10 70-day pancreas kidney transplant, and we did 2 or 3 as pancreas transplant alone last year.
This year we have
done 2 already.
Yeah.
So this one patient we did recently, she was 50 years old, she had diabetes for 30 years, and she is a perfect patient, very compliant. But recently she started noticing some hypoglycemic unawareness, and then she realized that this is the time I need a pancreas transplant. She got listed, she got pancreas transplant within 2 weeks. So because now it seems like we have more organs available and we have less patients waiting for pancreas transplant alone, at least the wait list is so short. Any other questions? All right, thank you so much. Thanks for coming.